When it comes to people in powerful positions, you can't always take them at their word.
I want you to listen to me. I'm going to say this again. I did not have sexual relations with that woman, Miss Lewinsky. I never told anybody to lie, not a single time.
Often you need to take what they say with a pinch of salt.
My blood is black, green and gold. I will never form a political party. I'm born African National Congress. I will die African National Congress.
And sometimes what they say is just downright ridiculous.
There's a Chevy in there. I think it's two streets away from the Gupta house. Now, I will not admit or deny that I was going to the Shebeen, but because I haven't, my young wife is not aware that there's a Shebeen there. But there's a Shebeen there.
And that's where we find ourselves this week on The Story. It all comes down to a love triangle, one that involves Minister Mantashe, another minister, and a so-called slay queen. Now, you'd think a sex scandal would be the thing that would be dominating headlines if it involved ministers, but alas, it is not. In fact, the story behind the story is actually one of allegations of bribery. You're listening to The Story. It's a new podcast from News 24. Every week, we're going to take you inside our newsroom. We'll speak to journalists and experts about the week's biggest story. This is what we saw, heard, and uncovered this week.
I have no statement. A church who issued the statement. You are putting the cart before the horse.
That was our Mineral Resources Minister Gwede Mantashe pretty much running away from journalists on Tuesday outside Parliament, telling us that we're putting the cart before the horse. I'm joined in studio by News 24's Rian Grobler, who's been reporting on this story. Rian, here we find ourselves speaking about yet another sex scandal.
And yet, the attention seems to have been drawn away from the actual sex scandal. We're referring, of course, to the report by Sunday World about an alleged love triangle, if you will, between what they refer to as Slay Queen Lerato Makgato and the Finance Minister Tito Mboweni and our Public Enterprises and Energy Minister Gwede Mantashe.
In fact, that headline made me giggle. Two ministers and a fed-up Slay Queen.
And a fed-up Slay Queen. That being said, there was a sidebar next to the story. The newspaper Sunday World approached Minister Mantashe to elicit comment from him. And he then made the revelation saying that he had previously paid two journalists to make the story go away to the tune of 70,000 rand. And that blew up and became the actual story.
Rian, I just want to interject for a moment here to point out that when it comes to Minister Mboweni and his relationship with this woman, he is a single man engaging in a relationship with an adult woman. So really, as far as things go, not much of a scandal to speak of here. The real kind of scandal of it all is that Minister Mantashe is a married man. So here we're dealing with an extramarital affair that has the potential to cause real reputational risk or reputational harm, at least. So anyway, what happened next?
The editor of Sunday World, Makuru Sefara, then claims that he called Mantashe back to verify what had been said to the reporter. And he told me that Mantashe then repeated the claim to him that the journalist had been paid 70,000 rand and that he was not prepared to pay another journalist to make the story go away, and that was his comment. Sefara told me that he had recorded the conversation and that Minister Mantashe was welcome to sue the newspaper because they are prepared to stand by their story.
Right, so we've got the Sunday World adamant that they're willing to go to court for this. So what was Mantashe's response to all of this? What did he say?
It took until Tuesday for Minister Mantashe to come up with a response. And the response didn't come from him personally, but from the chief of staff of his department. It was a very short statement, which merely said, The statement attributed to him seems to have created an impression of him being involved in the act of bribery. Mr. Mantashe is clear that none of the sort occurred. Further attested to by the newspaper, there was no verification of these allegations prior to the publication of the story, and that Mr. Mantashe, both in his personal capacity and that of being the executive authority, believes in upholding the integrity of the media and media freedom. And that was it.
So from Sunday, when the news breaks, all the way up to Wednesday, we have Mantashe not saying much, just, you know, speaking through his spokesperson and official channels and kind of delivering a bit of a confusing mixed message. Then Thursday comes around and we get this statement from SANEF saying that they've actually met with the minister and he's confirmed three things. The first is that, yeah, he had said that he had bribed journalists. I mean, those statements in the Sunday World are true. But then he says he hadn't actually paid any money. He said he paid money, but he hadn't actually paid money. And then the third thing, which I think is quite significant, is that he says he'd be subject to the processes of an inquiry into media ethics and credibility around this, presumably understanding the seriousness of him firstly saying that he had offered the bribe and then affirming that he just said it, but he didn't actually do it. Now, we've heard from the Sunday World, we've heard from the editor, we've heard from the minister, who's kind of said things in bits and bobs in a kind of contradictory way. But what is the ANC saying about this? Because this is serious.
The ANC has come out in support of Mantashe. They said that they were heartened by his denial of the bribery allegations. The ANC spokesperson, Pulimabe, issued a statement saying that the fact that Mantashe had made the assurances that he was never involved in criminal or unethical conduct was acceptable to them, and that they believe that bribing journalists is not only criminal and unethical, but is also inconsistent with the values of the ANC.
Right. So, as it stands, no denial of the actual affair, denial of the fact that he could have potentially bribed journalists.
And the denials are also interesting in the sense that it's not as defiant as one would expect. Firstly, there was no outright denial of the alleged affair. And secondly, in the denial of the report that he had allegedly bribed journalists, there was no call for a retraction or threats of legal action or anything. It was just a straight up and down three paragraph, I didn't do it.
Obviously, this is a developing story. Day by day, we're getting new tidbits of information. So News 24 is going to be keeping our readers and our listeners updated on this. Rian, where can people contact you if they want more on the story or if they've got a juicy tip?
I'm reachable on Twitter. My handle is at bragrobis. That's BRAGROBBIES.
Excellent. Rian Krobler, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thanks, Jerusha.
For me, through this whole story, there are two main issues that keep cropping up in my mind, and I can't shake them. The first is the really obvious implication and the serious implication on journalism here. We have essentially a minister saying that he had offered bribes to journalists, and even though he's backpedaled on Thursday and said, you know, he said he did, but he didn't really. Let's just follow this through to a logical conclusion. Let's say he had. That means that there are journalists sitting in a newsroom in this country who are potentially brown envelope journalists, you know, having received money, bribe money, not to publish a story. That's serious, and it's got serious implications for the industry. So that's the first thing that I keep thinking about. The second has to do with Mantashe himself. Mantashe the minister, or, you know, Mantashe the mess. And this is actually just kind of the latest in a string of unfortunate incidents involving him. So to unpack this a little further, I'm joined in studio by Peter Dutoy. He's the assistant editor here at News 24, and he's going to help us make sense of it. Peter, thanks so much for joining us.
Jerusha, it's a disaster all around. The politics of the matter can keep us busy for days on end, but from a journalistic point of view as well, and that's where you and I operate in, is we're a profession under enormous pressure in terms of ethics, in terms of sustainability, in terms of our role in society. And when this something like this comes along, after some incidents over the last couple of weeks where journalists were implicated at the Zondo Commission, you know, this couldn't have come at a worse time, where a minister says that he paid off two journalists and two journalists actually took the money. It was quite remarkable for Mantashe to admit to something like that to a newspaper. You know, it's problematic on a political side, and on the journalistic side as well.
Yeah. Well, let's talk a bit about Mantashe, the man in a political sphere.
Yes.
Look, Peter, he's a bit of a mess at the moment. The mess that is Mantashe is kind of touching all spheres of party leadership. Chat to us about that.
Look, Mantashe, when he was appointed Minister of Mineral Affairs, he, according to many trade union leaders, was a breath of fresh air, because the very controversial mining charter seemed to have gotten stuck under the previous minister, and certainly Minister Mosebenziswane, who was a Zuma minister. And he was very open to the issues that the mining industry brought forward, and was apparently much more open to seeking middle ground between government and the mining industry. But on a political level, as chairperson of the ANC, you know, he's also seen as closer to President Cyril Ramaphosa than he was to the Nkosazana Dlamini Zuma camp. But the problem, Jerusha, is that this minister deals with an industry under pressure, just like journalism is. The mining industry, there's lots of money involved, lots of capital investment. It's a big driver for the economy. Now, if you have a minister who is supposed to be involved in negotiating contracts, or, you know, dishing out concessions or licenses to mine and all the rest of it, and he admits to paying bribes, that's a massive problem.
Yeah. In fact, you know, the scandal aside, his policies are not landing either. The most recent integrated resource plan, largely coal dependent, unsustainable. We've run a couple op-ed pieces saying as much. In a world that desperately needs sustainability, it seems like the minister's plans are falling behind.
His wife actually owns a company that in the past has provided coal to Eskom. So, you know, there's conflict there as well. You know, not only is his family involved in the mining industry and the energy industry with Eskom and electricity provision, you know, the IRP has fallen way behind. It's years behind. It is still very much coal focused. And as with many things in this government, the policies aren't aligned with what we can actually afford. The policies aren't well thought through, and the policies aren't always implemented, well, almost never implemented, like we've seen with the medium-term budget policy statement this week. So on a governance level, you know, there are issues in Mantashe's department, but certainly on an ethical level, the president needs to take action. And you know what's frightening, Jerusha, is ever since the story's come out, there's been a deafening silence from the presidency. This story has all but sunk without trace, and I think that's the problem. There's no accountability.
In an ideal blue sky environment in government, what should happen? What should the president be doing?
Well, the president should put Mr. Mantashe on leave, appoint an acting minister to that department, and then he should launch a proper investigation into whether or not one of his ministers did in actual fact pay a bribe. Now, the spin that's coming from Mantashe's office is, yes, he might have said that, but he didn't mean it, he didn't pay a bribe. Then why say it? Why say something like that?
Why say it twice?
You know, does that mean that you are open to paying or receiving bribes? You know, the law governing corruption says that the person who pays the bribes is equally as guilty as the person who receives the bribe. So, you know, there's no way in getting around this. The president should put him on leave, should launch an investigation, and should take the public into his confidence about what he finds.
That's News 24 Assistant Editor Peter Dutoy. Thanks for chatting with us today. The Story is a weekly podcast by News 24. It's hosted by me, Jerusha Sukhdeo-Raath, and produced and edited by Nokuthula Manyathi. For more on this story, visit news24.com.